Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for this live conversation. As we celebrate the unofficial start of summer this weekend, it's important to also keep your health in mind, especially as we're out in the sun. According to the CDC, skin cancer is the most common cancer in the United States. So today we brought in Dr. Courtney Guerrieri to discuss skin cancer and the signs and symptoms. She's a dermatologist here at Christiana Care, and is here to answer all of your questions that you may have about skin cancer and taking care of your skin this summer. Dr. Guerrieri, thank you so much for joining us. Please take a minute to introduce yourself.
Hi, thanks, Megan. Thanks for having me. I'm Courtney Guerrieri. I'm one of the dermatologists here at Christiana Care. I've been here for about 3 years. And prior to that, I was here part-time and at Jefferson for part-time. It's Dr. Hirakawa and myself are the two dermatologists here, and we have two different office locations, MAT 2 down by the hospital, and we're right now in our Lancaster Pike office, which is located in Wilmington.
Thank you, and I just want to remind our viewers, if you have any questions for Dr. Guerrieri, to leave those in the comments below, and we'll get to them throughout our conversation. So Dr. Guerrieri, as I mentioned, skin cancer, most common cancer in the United States. Why is that?
So likely from UV exposure, as time's gone on, more and more UV reaches the Earth's surface and our activities have changed. Many people spend more time out in the sun now than in the past. So most skin cancers are mostly related to UV exposure. So that's likely why it's one of the most common cancers.
So you talked about UV exposure. Is that the main and really only cause of skin cancer, or are there other factors as well?
So it's a good question. It is the main, likely the main cause, but there are some genes associated with it. That's why it's important to know if you have a family history, particularly for melanoma. There are some known gene mutations for melanoma, and there's probably a lot of mutations that we do not know about, but we do see melanomas run in families. There are also some genetic disorders that make people more susceptible to the sun, and those patients are also at increased risk for basal cell and squamous cell in addition to melanoma.
So you've mentioned the different types of skin cancer. Let's dive a little deeper and talk about the differences between those three.
Sure. So the three main types are basal cell, squamous cell, and melanoma. And basal cell is probably the most type of the most common type of cancer. It's the most common type of skin cancer we see. And we usually tell people when they're looking for this kind of cancer, these ones are slow growing cancers. They kind of get bigger in place. They don't really go inside the body, but they're important to find because they can eventually get deeper and cause tissue damage. So we do remove those surgically. Squamous cell cancer is kind of the intermediate cancer. So that one usually also stays in place, but it has the potential to cause problems. It has the potential to metastasize or go inside the body and go to other organs, especially if left alone. And finally, melanoma, we all know that's the bad one we're all looking for, one of the most deadly types of cancers. And it metastasizes fairly quickly and has, unfortunately, poor prognosis when caught too late.
So does family history play a role in any of this? Should people be keeping that in mind?
So family history you're asking me about? I'm sorry, that came out for a minute. So family history is important for melanoma. And usually if you have a strong family history, we recommend getting skin checks. And if you have a personal history of skin cancer, we certainly want to have more frequent skin checks because your risk of having a second skin cancer within the year after or the first 3 years after your first is much higher. It's important, especially family history of melanoma and significant melanomas are all important factors.
What about the environmental factors? Is it the sun and only the sun, or should we be considering other factors as well?
So it's a good question and probably one we don't know the definitive answer to, but obviously the sun is the one we worry about the most, but probably carcinogens in the environment play a role, particularly for some of the melanoma mutations, but those are things we can't measure, we don't know about. So as dermatologists, our primary concern is for UV exposure, because we know that one definitely causes skin cancer.
And what about tanning?
So tanning beds are another problem. Amazingly, a lot of people don't realize the dangers of tanning. They think it's safer than the sun, and it's not. It's still UV exposure. So even though it may be UVA or UVB, it's still the same type of UV that we get from the sun that causes skin cancer. people who tan under the age of 30 have much higher risks of melanoma. Basal cell and squamous cell, I think your risk of melanoma is 20% from a history of tanning. So important things to think about. Fortunately, in Delaware, we have some good legislation to prevent teens under age 18 from tanning.
So what signs and symptoms should people be looking for, especially for those of us who are prone to being very freckly over the summer and don't necessarily always know what's new and not new?
Yeah, it's tough. We usually recommend a skin check about once a year so that we can look at things, but we have patients check their skin at home too. We usually tell people maybe about once a month, just look around. On the day of your birthday is a good way to remember. We look for the three different types of skin cancer. So for basal cell, I mentioned they're slow growing. They kind of look like pimples, but just won't go away. They sometimes start to itch or maybe burn a little bit. And then they can bleed. So sometimes if you're, using a towel or a hairbrush and you hit them, that's a sign and they bleed. That's a sign that they potentially are skin cancer. Squamous cell, we mentioned the intermediate type of one. That one usually is pink patches that get thicker and thicker over time. It's kind of like that scab that you keep picking at, but it just keeps coming back. That's usually a warning sign for squamous cell. And melanoma, we've all talked about the one we worry about the most. And most of the time we're looking for brown spots, brown spots that are changing, getting bigger, or asymmetric. There's the ABCDs, which you can, it's a simple mnemonic to remember and always can look up on the AAD for some examples of those things. But for us, mostly it's evolution. So that's the E of the ABCDs. And so that's change, getting bigger, asymmetric, those things you want to look for. But also remember that not all melanomas have pigment. So some are amelanotic melanomas, which means that they're not brown, they're just pink. So always having patients look for that big pink bump or the strange pink thing that's popped up that just isn't going away.
I'm sure many of our viewers are headed to either the Delaware beaches or the Jersey Shore this weekend to kick off Memorial Day holiday. What should they keep in mind as they're packing up for the beach? The extra sunscreen, the chapstick, what are those things they need to make sure in their bag this weekend?
So absolutely, sunscreen is the most important. So make sure it's 30 and above. If you're going for a weekend, one bottle is probably enough, but you have to think if you're going for the week, you maybe want to bring more than one because you should be reapplying at a consistent frequency. A hat is always good to protect the scalp. Also, the hat will provide some shade on your face. Sunglasses to protect your eyes from the sun because we can get melanoma there also. And I'm a big proponent also of chapsticks or lip balms that contain sunscreen because that's an area that I think that's forgotten, our lips. And some of the skin cancers, we see some squamous cells in that area. And there's not a lot of tissue around there. So we try to keep that area preserved. So I usually pack up a bag with some SPF 30 lip balm to make sure you're reapplying because obviously that's coming off a lot.
So for reapplying, how often would you recommend doing that?
So for the body, every hour and a half to 2 hours is fine. Unless you have a lot of exposure to water or you're really sweating, then probably after those exposures. For the lips, I think you need to do more than that because you're constantly licking your lips, you're eating. So anytime you kind of feel that chapstick is gone off your lips, you should probably reapply.
And what about kids? Is there an even higher risk for kids in that sunscreen department, or should it be kind of on the same timeline as the adults?
So kids should be about the same timeline. Usually sunscreen is recommended for ages 6 months and up. But they should be every hour and a half to 2 hours. I like sun protective clothing for kids because I feel like kids are a little bit tougher. They squirm, they run, they're in the water, they're harder to reapply. So, if you get them the rash guard shirts that have some SPF in them and a nice hat, and if you can get them to wear sunglasses, even better. But they should be treated similarly. So with the exception of babies, because under the age of 6 months, it's not recommended to have a lot of sunscreen on, just because their skin's more fragile and permeable. So we try to recommend not much sun exposure at all under the age of 6 months. And if you are gonna have a baby out in the sun for intermittent sun exposure, hats, clothing, maybe a little bit of sunscreen on the back of the hands, that kind of thing.
And a nice umbrella. We do have our first question from our viewer, Rose, and it ties right into this conversation. you know, what should parents do for their children to protect their skin? So, you know, we just talked about the beach. What about that, the weekends, baseball and soccer games or summer camps or the things that maybe the parents aren't right there with them all the time?
That makes it hard. I mean, I do, my kids wear sunscreen even when they're going out to play. So I think it's important anytime children are going to spend any time outside that you lather them up in sunscreen. I think the more you do that, the more they get used to it, the more they expect it. So you'll find that as they get a little older, they get a little responsibility. You give them a little container that they can take with them and they'll do it. They'll reapply it. They also make sunscreen sticks, which are easy for kids to use on their own faces, particularly at school where maybe they're not getting reapplied. Ideally at summer camp for young children, they should hopefully be reapplying sunscreen for them. But you can give them some of those little things and make it a normal thing for them so that they expect to do that. And obviously hats are important. And you know, if you can get them to get some rash guards and things when they're in the pool, that would be good also.
And do you have any guidance for the older adults who maybe 20 years ago were doing the tanning beds, were constantly at the beach and don't do that really anymore, but maybe still you can tell on their skin that they had that skin exposure?
Yeah. So I know we can't go back in time. Wish we could. Those are the types of patients that we really watch. Some of them have more frequent skin checks than every year. Sometimes for some of those patients, we use retinoids or some other things to sort of help with some sun damage on the chest if they have a lot of brown spots or they're getting a lot of early skin cancers or precancers. And then we tell them the same thing, just make sure you're lathering up in your sunscreen, you're protecting yourself as much as possible. You're wearing your hat, you're keeping your sunscreen in your purse, or you're keeping your sunscreen in your car so you don't go somewhere and then forget to use it. So that's a big population of people. And so the most important thing for them is not only just sunscreen now, but closer monitoring for some of those people.
And what's your opinion on the makeup that already has SPF in it, the foundations or the concealers that are advertised as containing that SPF?
So I think those are okay for daily sun exposure. So, you know, you're getting up, you're going to work, you're in and out of the car, you're in and out of the office, ambient sun throughout the window. I think that's okay. If you're going to be at the beach, if you're going to be at a baseball game and you're going to be outside, if you're even going to be out and gardening, you should be putting true sunscreen on your face. You know, the makeups protect to some degree, but there's nothing that beats that true sunscreen.
So what are the screening tests for skin cancer? If someone's watching and thinks they may have a questionable spot, what should they do and what should they expect?
So if they have a spot of concern, they should call a dermatologist, get in to have the spot examined. Oftentimes they can also ask for a skin check. So that means that not only do we look for that one spot, but we look all over the skin. So they should kind of expect to come in and have their skin looked at. So oftentimes we give patients a gown, but ask them to just to basically take everything off except for their underwear underneath. So just kind of be prepared for that coming in. We take your shoes and your socks off. We look between your toes. We look at the part of your hair. And a good idea, if possible, is to not wear makeup. Just, you know, so we can see as best as we can underneath. Sometimes if people have too much foundation on, it makes it a little hard to assess.
So we do have another question from our viewers. Tina asks, can you use sunscreen that's a year old?
I say no on that. Now, there's definitely an expiration date on them, and I hate to throw away things, but I try to get a fresh bottle every year. And really, if you're using the amount of sunscreen that you're supposed to be using, which is 2 ounces every 2 hours, that's a lot of sunscreen. So my question is, really, should you have any bottles for next year, right? You should be getting through them. So I try not to. I just feel like it breaks down over time. But, you know, there is an expiration date, so you could go buy those if you want.
So if you have any extra from Labor Day that you're now taking out for Memorial Day, check the expiration date, see how much is left, buy some new stuff, and phase that out.
In my opinion, yes. I always buy fresh. I buy fresh every single summer.
So, you know, going back to those appointments, we know with COVID and the pandemic, so many people have put off appointments or have, you know, decided to skip their yearly skin checks or whatever the case may be. Why is it important that we really keep on top of that?
So it's a good question. It is important that we keep on top of it because, you know, we're looking for some of the most, you know, one of the most deadly types of cancers, which is melanoma. And the earlier we can catch it, the better. So, you know, although we understand when COVID first came, you know, when we first got into this COVID pandemic, you know, everything was COVID, but melanoma is still out there. Melanoma is still, you know, people are still getting melanomas. And the longer you ignore some of these things, the worse prognosis some things have. I mean, and that even holds true for basal cell. People who have basal cells and leave them for a while, they just get bigger, bigger and bigger. And it makes repair and surgery much more difficult for the patient.
So what kind of PPE are you wearing? What kind of safety measures is your practice putting into place to make sure the patients feel as safe as possible when they come to see you in person?
So we've tried from the beginning. We actually have two office locations. So we've separated Dr. Hirakawa and myself. So we have a less patient load in each location. We've spaced out appointments so that there's not a lot of patients sitting in the waiting room at any one time. Certainly when you come up, there's a temperature check and a history to make sure there was no exposure. Everybody in the office is masked until you're back in the exam room. We do take the mask off for evaluation of your face for a short period of time in the exam room. Dr. Hirakawa and I still are, you know, wear face masks and shields. And of course, we're all vaccinated, and hopefully going forward, that's going to be an issue, or if not an issue, a good thing going forward. We also clean the rooms down after every patient. We have multiple rooms so that we can switch it around. You know, we use fresh pillowcases, everything that we use is all clean. So I think it's probably a pretty safe environment for patients.
That's great. So before I let you go, what do you think is the number one thing you want viewers to take away from this conversation today?
It's a good question. I think the number one thing is probably sun protection, followed closely by keeping an eye on your skin. I think that, like I said, during COVID, these have been hard times. And, you know, most of us, the only thing we've been able to do is be outdoors. And I think all of those things are okay as long as we're doing it safely. You know, make sure you're protecting your skin, protecting your eyes, protecting your lips, protecting your scalp with, you know, hats or sunscreen powders. They do make these things in order to protect those areas. So that, you know, going forward, we have less of a population of patients who are coated in sun damage and cancers and precancers.
Well, thank you so much for all of the information. I'm sure it was incredibly helpful. And hopefully a few of our viewers will run out and buy that extra bottle of sunscreen for vacation this weekend.
I hope
And if you're watching and have any other questions or want to learn more about the dermatology program here at ChristianaCare, you can click the link in our comments below or ask your question in the comments below, and we'll get back to you once this live is over. Thank you so much and have a great day.